Hi, everybody. Today, I am joined by the fantastic Megan Van Dyke, author of the even more fantastic Second Stars to the Left, and the upcoming Bargain with the Faking, correct?
That's right.
Okay, and both of those are from City Owl Press, and so let's just jump right in. So why don't you tell us a little bit about yourself?
All right, so Megan Van Dyke here. Currently live in Colorado with my family, and when I'm not writing, I'm usually mothering these days. They do have a lot of history doing IT security work as well, so that was kind of my background. But when I became a mom, I needed to get off the road a little bit and not be traveling every week like I was, and it actually opened up an opportunity to write more, which was great, because before that I was just kind of squeezing it in anywhere I could with airplanes and hotel rooms and just any spare moment I could find. And that's actually how I wrote my first two books, which aren't out yet, but one of those is A Bargain with the Faking, but it has since been rewritten many times because the first one was just a disaster. But the premise stayed the same, but the actual book itself is very different from how I wrote it the first time. But yeah, so I kind of wrote in my spare moments, and anytime my kid was napping, I was like, this is a great time to write. And sometimes that wasn't very much. And sometimes it was more, and nights and weekends and kind of any little scrap time I could get. And yeah, just kept going. And Second Star to the Left is my first published book, a debut. And it actually kind of came from a darker time when I was thinking about giving up writing, because it had a lot of rejection and lack of success, for a better word. And I was just like, dang, like I've done all this, and yet, yeah, I, you know, didn't feel successful. And so I just wrote something purely for me. And thankfully, it seems like a lot of people have really liked it too. So that's been great.
Well, I can guarantee you that I loved it. So, so you mentioned some spare time. What do you do in your spare time now? Do you have any spare time, or?
I really wish I did. Not so much. A lot of it still goes to parenting and helping out with, you know, around the house and doing all that, as well as writing, reading, trying to get this author career off the ground, and then also helping out with some family projects as well. So my husband's in real estate, and so I help a little bit with some of the development and design work there too. So it's kind of a hodgepodge of things that keeps me on my toes these days. But when I do have spare time, I like to cook. I love like anything savory, but I also really like to bake. Love to be outside, which Colorado is great for, and video games have always had a place in my heart, though I don't feel like I get to play them as much as I used to before I had kids.
I get that. What's your favorite video game?
Oh gosh, I've always been addicted to the Final Fantasy series. They have a very special place in my heart, and always will, and I will play every single one that ever comes available. And The Legends of Zelda too is another one that when they release a new one, like, just block out my calendar, because I'm gonna be all over that.
Pretty much. Yep. I never really got into Final Fantasy, but I'm really big into Kingdom Hearts, and the two kind of go hand in hand sometimes. So I get it. So let's talk about what got you into writing. You know, what started the whole process? You know, what sparked the Megan Van Dyke road to success?
It's a good question. So I've kind of always dabbled in writing throughout most of my life. I mean, I feel like I lived in the library as a little kid, because my mom could take us there and we could just get books and read and do all the summer reading programs and things. And so I've always kind of written, but I had never written more than like a few chapters of something. I was like, oh, I've got this book idea. And then I'd write like three chapters and that would be it. And then I'd forget about writing for a while. And then maybe I'd write another chapter or two of something, but never really could complete anything. And I was, you know, kind of went through life like that. And I'd go through phases where I'd, you know, like, I'm going to do this. I'm going to write this book now. And then it just wouldn't happen, or I'd start and I'd never finish. And so it wasn't until really until I was 30 and I was working all the time and I was reading a lot, which was great because I traveled all the time for work. So I was always on airplanes and going different places and in hotels. And so I had a lot of time to read, but then like a lot of these story ideas kind of kept coming back up to me. And there was one time I remember it very clearly because I was on a flight across the country and I opened up this book by one of my favorite authors and I was like disappointed. And it wasn't because it wasn't a great book, because it was amazing. I mean, everything she puts out is amazing. But it wasn't what I wanted to read, because the story I really wanted to read was in my head. And I knew that that's the moment I'm like, I have to write this story, because this idea, these characters will not leave me alone. And that's what really started me writing. And I just took any time that I had. And sometimes it'd just be a paragraph. Sometimes I'd write a page. And, you know, I eventually got there because it was such a compelling idea that I just, it would not leave me alone. And I had to have that story. And actually was a bargain with the Fae King. And I just knew I had to write it, and it wouldn't leave me alone until I did.
That's so awesome. I love hearing stuff like that. Like, you know, the stuff that just won't, like you said, just won't leave you alone. And it's just always there and present and persistent. And then you just have to get it on the page. I love that. I love that.
Yeah.
So who is your, I guess, because you mentioned, you know, you were reading a lot. Do you have a favorite author that you tend to go back to, or like an inspiration that you draw from, or?
It would be hard to pick just one. I think at the time I was actually reading the Fever series by Karen Monning, and love that series. It was really an impactful one on my life, just in that I feel like it's one of the few book series that's made me change the way I think about myself and how I approach things. Because I know she has a part in there where it's talking about getting to the deepest part of yourself and who are you when you strip away like all the labels of the world. And that's something that's always stayed with me. And I feel like it's unique to find a book that has something that really changes the way you view yourself. And I mean, you know, it's an urban fantasy paranormal book. It's not probably, that wasn't the goal, but it really had that effect on me and really just has always stayed with me since I read that years ago. Love Cressley Cole as well. I'm so glad she's writing again, because I will read everything that she puts out and have read tons of them. Love Jennifer Armentrout, Sarah J. Maas, a lot of those authors that write in that similar vein. And I mean, there's quite a number of them that if they have a new book coming out, it's on my list and you're going to read it as soon as I get time, which isn't always as much time as I would like these days. Sometimes things sit around a little while longer than I'd like before I get to them. But yeah, there's definitely some of those authors that have me for life.
Yes. And I think you are one of the authors who have me for life. So I don't know.
That's wild. Know
I don't know how that makes you feel or whatever, but I'm obsessed with you. So it's fine.
Well, thank you. That's really exciting.
Do you have any current reads? Do you have anything that you're super excited about right now, or?
Well, I just finished Neon Gods by Katie Robert. That was a good one. I mean, I'd seen it recommended everywhere, but it was more of a modern setting. I usually like fantasy that's like second world or something like that. But I guess it is kind of, in a way, even though it's like a modern setting, it's definitely not our everyday world, even though it feels a lot like it in some respects. So I feel like for me, that was still enough of a fantastical element that it was able to really draw me in and hook me. And I've read a lot of her books lately, and they've just been very good.
Oh, I'm sorry. I didn't mean to interrupt you. I just said that I'll have to check it out.
Yeah, no, I mean, it's definitely very steamy. Like even for me, and I write steamier, but it was good. I didn't know if I would like it, and I really did. So that was, and now I've got to pick up the second one, because I was like, oh, now I need the next book. And thankfully it's already out, so I can go get it.
Well, good. Good. That's always good. So you mentioned earlier that Second Star to the Left, while it's not your, you know, first book per se, it is your debut.
Yep.
So were there any lessons you learned with writing this one that, you know, you'll kind of carry into your future writing?
Definitely. So I think one of the things that's made this book successful, at least I feel like it is so far, and made people like it, is that I tried to put in everything that I like. And when I was writing it, I wasn't caring about like, oh, you know, are other people going to like this? Is this going to be what's cool in the market right now? Which I had done with some of my previous books, like trying to kind of fit into what I thought people would like. And I just went full on, like, if I like it, I'm throwing it in there. and I think honestly, that's what makes it really good, is that it's just purely wholly, like, it was fun to write. I really enjoyed the whole process of it. And I think a lot of that's what makes it fun to read. Like if I enjoy writing it, then hopefully, you know, people are going to enjoy reading it too. And I think just kind of leaning into you know, the weird, the fun, the exciting, yeah. and just running with it is part of what made it really good and really special. And that's what I've tried to do with the things that I've been writing since then, is just really leaning into what do I want in the story and kind of being almost self-indulgent in the way I write it and just throwing it all out there, because I think honestly that really shines through. And hopefully if I like it, then people that like that book will like the other books too, if I continue to to lean into what I want and not think about like market and publishing and, you know, what maybe in trend or anything like that.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, that's, at least on my part, I could definitely tell that there was passion, you know, for the craft in the book. Mm-hmm. And I'm pretty sure my husband could too, because we both couldn't put it down. I mean, we were both reading it at the same time, and it was just, it was so much fun to read. And, you know, we could really tell that you put so much care into this magical retelling, and it's so incredible. It really is. So were there any, on that, in that kind of same vein, were there any specific challenges to writing Second Star to the Left? Or, you know, because it is a retelling of one of the most popular fairy tales of all time, Peter Pan, but you know, you took it in such a unique direction. So was there anything super hard, or did you find anything easier?
I think the one difficulty with this one is I didn't go into it with a plan. So usually when I write a book, I at least know the major points and where mm-hmm. it's going and where the characters are going to end up. But this one, it didn't start with any plan. I really didn't even know if it would be a whole book. I just knew I kind of had this wacky idea about Tinkerbell being exiled for selling pixie dust, and, you know, her and Captain Hook having some animosity because she accidentally got him cursed in the process of trying to get home. And I just kind of ran with it. I didn't know if I'd write like a chapter or a couple chapters or what it would even turn into, but I got maybe a fourth of the way into the book and was like, this is really something. Like, this isn't just, mm-hmm. you know, like there's something here. It's more than just me having fun and kind of writing nonsense. And so at that point I was like, okay, I need to like figure out the rest of this plot. So I actually wrote it in chunks. You know, I wrote the first fourth of it, and then I was like, wow, I really like these characters in the story. I think it's going somewhere. And then I had to kind of stop and figure out where it was going. Yeah. And I actually ended up then writing some of the later scenes to make sure I fully understood like some of the antagonists and where they were coming from and why they were doing what they were doing. And sometimes the best way for me to do that is to actually just write the scene and really get in there with the characters and figure out what's going on. And that kind of allowed me to figure out the rest.
Okay. Yeah. Very cool. You kind of actually touched on something I wanted to ask you a little bit later, but I'll go ahead and ask you now. Do you consider yourself a plotter, or, you know, you mentioned that on this one, you were kind of pantsing it, but how would you categorize yourself?
I feel like I'm a plotter, but I'm not as much of a plotter as some people. I know a lot of people will have like detailed written character backstories mm-hmm. and index cards and everything. And I'm not that person. I feel like I have a lot of it up here in my head, but I don't generally take the time to write it all out in detail. I do usually come up with a high level outline that kind of has the major plot points of like, mm-hmm. here's the big things that are going to happen in the story. But then the little details and how we get from point A to point B, sometimes I let that evolve as it will in the scene. And sometimes that means some of the plot points have to change a little bit, but I usually try to follow my characters. Like, they know what's right for their story. And if they say, whoa, no, this is not how it goes, this is actually how it goes over here, then I try to run with that, because they're right. I mean, it's their story.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. There'll be like a tension there, I feel like, when I'm writing, if I know something's not right, and it just almost won't let me continue.
Yeah. Yeah. I go through a lot of the same things. So would you consider yourself more of a character driven writer then, rather than plot, or is it kind of like an equal footing kind of thing?
It's a bit of an equal footing. I'd say when I first started out, I was much more plot driven. Like, I had plot ideas, but didn't know so much about the characters. And I think that was one of the weaknesses of some of my early manuscripts, is that there was a lot happening, but not really happening to the characters. And there just wasn't that depth of character that there needed to be, which is probably why a lot of this didn't work out. or at least at the time. Some of them I've gone back and revisited and scrubbed them up quite a good bit. But now I'd say I'm much more character driven. Like until I really know the characters, it's hard for me to tell their story because it's so much of them that drives like what happens and where things are going and what the obstacles are going to be. So I'd say that's a big change for me. And that I really almost can't write until I've sat with the characters for a while and gotten to know them.
I completely get that. You know, I'm losing my words. Character is such a big portion of the book that it's kind of hard to have a story without compelling characters. And that was something that I loved so much about Second Star to the Left, and something that I'm looking forward to in your other works because your characters are so good.
Well, thank you.
Oh, you're very welcome. So what would you say kind of characterizes your writing style, since we're kind of on the topic? What sets you apart from everybody else?
I don't know. I probably shouldn't have an answer to that, but no, not sure. I feel like my brand is sexy magical adventures because that's what I like to write, and that's kind of what all the stories have in common, is that, you know, it's a fun adventure, there should be thrilling moments and excitement, but it's also got that heart to it.
Yes.
And some heat as well. And that's something that's, I feel like, is consistent across everything that I write. And is that little linkage that binds them all together. So I don't know if that's quite what's unique about it, but that's definitely a central tone, if you were, for all the stories. And some of you are a little darker, some are a little funnier, but you should hopefully have a mix of both. I think not to get too dark with anything.
Yeah, I think that's definitely a valid answer because, you know, there's such a stigma with romance and fantasy. So what's your take on that? How do you feel about all the romance naysayers in fantasy?
I mean, I think they're missing out personally because it's always so character driven. I mean, to really write a compelling romantic storyline, you have to have really solid, deep characters. Otherwise it's just gonna not work at all. So I really think people are missing out. I mean, I know it turns some people off and it may not be their cup of tea, but there's so much depth to it and so much heart. And I would much rather have like that sparring of emotions and words than like a battle scene. Honestly, battle scenes are some of my least favorite to write. They're inevitable, especially in fantasy. And I mean, they definitely add spice to it, but I'd much rather, I really love those like intimate moments with the characters when there's so much more going on in words and actions than even just overall.
Yeah. So let me ask you this. What draws you to fantasy, like fantasy romance, rather than, you know, just like a romance?
For me, I think a little bit of it's escapism. Just I like stories that take me out of my everyday world, and whether that's a different version of our world or somewhere in space or, you know, a completely secondary fantasy world, I like something that's purely an escape and that like exposes me to new and different places and just feels like, yeah, more of an escape than just reading something that's set in a big city or something like that. To me, that while those are great and I've read some that are amazing, it doesn't feel like as much of a, like completely sweep me out of the world and let me escape from everyday life. And I don't know. And I just like the different things that like magic can bring to it. And I feel like you can get a lot more dramatic plot elements with like, you know, battle and war and magic and all these things going on that aren't always as present in like your typical contemporary romance, where it's more personal issues going on and not end of the world type situations.
Yeah. Yeah, I fully get that. Well, I don't have much else for you today. Why don't you tell us a little bit about what you've got coming up next? Besides what we know about Bargain of the Fae King.
Yep.
But there was a little, I don't want to give anything away, but there was a little bit of a hint in Second Star to the Left, I think. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
There is. So there's a hint at what's going to be book two in the Reimagined Fairy Tale series, which takes another fairy tale, or in this case, two, And reimagines them in a new way. And this one is going to be called The Ugly Stepsister. At least that's their temporary title. It hasn't been solidified yet, but I think that's what we're going with. It's coming from City Owl Press this fall, probably September. We're still settling on the final release date. But it is a mashup of Cinderella meets Snow White and has Anna, who's the ugly stepsister, trying to out the evil queen and get revenge for her family. And in this case, the evil queen is Cinderella, because Cinderella wasn't the victim in all her stories. She was actually the bully. And it also pairs her up with Will, who's an exiled royal huntsman who dissented the new queen's rise to power and is also trying to get revenge for his family members. And they end up pairing up to try to take down the evil queen.
That's so awesome. That's so exciting. I'm so excited. I can't wait.
Yeah, and there's lots of guest appearances by some of your other supporting cast members in those different tales. And it's fun. It definitely takes a different take on the trope because it's kind of post-Cinderella, concurrent Snow White-esque. And yeah, definitely makes you look at those characters in a different way. I think that's kind of my goal, is that, you know, while it's its own thing, hopefully it also makes you rethink about those original tales as well and just how things might be a little different than the normal happily ever after we know.
That's so awesome. I'm so excited for you. I can't wait.
Yeah. And well, it's actually longer too. So we can get a little bit of a longer book this time, hopefully, as long as nothing major gets cut out in the last phases of edits too. And yeah, so I'm really excited for that one. It's got some things that are near and dear to my heart. So I'm pretty excited for everyone to read that.
That's so very exciting. Do you have anything else?
Yeah, I have a bunch of things actually. But also currently writing on book three, or what I hope will be book three, knock on wood, in the Reimagined Fairy Tale series, which is a reimagining of Alice in Wonderland.
Ooh, we love that.
Oh yeah.
We do love that.
I don't know. It might be one of my favorite things I've ever written, just because it's very...
Oh gosh, that's so exciting. You
know, anytime you get into Wonderland, things can get a little weird. And it's just been really fun to kind of lean into that. And the characters on that one are so great too. I'm excited for everyone to hopefully see that one in 2023. It's not contracted yet, but hopefully we're going to get there. So
my fingers are so crossed for you. My sister adores Alice in Wonderland, so I'm going to shove it down her throat. Well, Megan, thank you so much for taking some time out of your weekend to talk with us. And I really appreciate you coming on and giving us some insight into what makes you tick and what makes your writing tick. And I just really appreciate you. So thank you so much.
Yeah, no, thank you very much for having me. This was great.
You're very welcome. Everybody, feel free to check out Megan at her socials. Do you want to go ahead and list those?
Yep. So it's author Megan Van Dyke for pretty much everywhere, except for Twitter, which is author Megan VD, because author Megan Van Dyke doesn't fit. And the website's the same, www.authormeganvandyke.com. And you can find everything linked there too.
Okay. Where can we find your books?
Most everywhere. Right now, Second Star to the Left is the only one out there. A Bargain with the Fae King should be going live soon. But there's links from my website, and they should be available at all major retailers.
Okay. Well, Megan, thank you again so much for coming on. This has been a wonderful chat, and I am so glad that I got to talk to you finally in person. I hope you have a fantastic weekend.
Yeah, thanks. You too.